Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to King of Kings on this Palm Sunday. Lent comes to an end with Jesus coming into Jerusalem to suffer, to die, and to rise again. His majesty is veiled in humility, and yet by faith, God gives us the grace to see him for who he is, the King of Kings and Lord of all, Lord of our lives, King of our universe. That's the thought of our worship today. We'll begin with the opening sentences. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord.
Hosanna to the Son of David.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Dear friends in Christ, for 5 weeks of Lent, we've been preparing for the celebration of our Lord's death and resurrection. Today we come together to begin the solemn celebration of Holy Week. Christ entered in triumph into his own city to complete his work as our Messiah, to suffer, to die, and to rise again. Let us remember with devotion his entry that culminated at the empty tomb and follow him with a lively faith. United with him by baptism, we share in his resurrection and new life. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord.
Hosanna in the highest.
Join me in singing, Prepare the Royal Highway, it's hymn 302. Please stand. As we enter this holy week of our Lord's Passion, let us confess our sins to God and to one another. God of compassion, we confess to you that we have sinned against you and against our neighbors. We have been prideful. We have sought to overrule your authority as Lord of our lives. We have not listened deeply to your word. We do not deserve your kindness. In your abundant compassion, forgive us, Lord, for the sake of your Son, who gave his life on the cross for us. The Lord is full of compassion. He gives life. He heals the wounds caused by our sin. Therefore, as a called servant of Christ and by his authority, I announce the grace of God to all of you. And in the place and by the command of our Lord Jesus Christ, I forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit.
Thanks be to God. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. We praise you, O God, for the great acts of love by which you have redeemed us through your Son, Jesus Christ. As he was acclaimed by those who sacrificed their garments, scattered their garments and branches of the palms in his path, so may we always hail him as our King and follow him with perfect confidence, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
You may be seated. The first lesson for today is recorded in the Old Testament book of Zechariah, chapter 9, verses 9 and 10. Zechariah foretells the coming of the Savior, Zion's King, in humility and in lowliness. He enters righteous and having salvation. He comes bringing peace between God and men. Rejoice greatly, daughter of Zion. Shout, daughter of Jerusalem. Look, your king is coming to you. He is righteous and brings salvation. He is humble and is riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey. I will cut off the chariot from Ephraim and the horse from Jerusalem. The battle bow will be taken away, and he will proclaim peace to the nations. His kingdom will extend from sea to sea, from the river to the ends of the earth. The word of the Lord. Our psalm for this morning is Psalm 24. It's on page 3 of your worship folder.
Thank you.
second lesson is recorded in Paul's epistle to the Philippians, chapter 2, verses 5 through 11. He calls on the believers in Philippi to be united and to imitate the attitude of Jesus, the attitude of humility. Indeed, let this attitude be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. Though he was by nature God, he did not consider equality with God as a prize to be displayed. But he emptied himself by taking the nature of a servant. When he was born in human likeness and his appearance was like that of any other man, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God also highly exalted him and gave him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus, every knee will bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. This is the word of the Lord. The hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. Please stand for the gospel. The Holy Gospel and also the sermon text is recorded in Matthew's Gospel, chapter 21, verses 1 through 11. Jesus enters Jerusalem in fulfillment of Zechariah's prophecy. As they approached Jerusalem and came to Bethphage on the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two disciples, telling them, "Go to the village ahead of you. Immediately you will find a donkey tied there along with her colt. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, you are to say, 'The Lord needs them,' and he will send them at once." This took place to fulfill what was spoken through the prophet. "Tell the daughter of Zion, 'Look, your king comes to you, humble and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey.'" The disciples went and did just as Jesus commanded them. They brought the donkey and the colt, laid their outer clothing on them, and he sat on it. A very large crowd spread their outer clothing on the road. Others were cutting branches from the trees and spreading them out on the road. The crowds who went in front of him and those who followed him kept shouting, "Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest." When he entered Jerusalem, the whole city was stirred up, asking, "Who is this?" And the crowds were saying, "This is Jesus, the prophet from Nazareth in Galilee." This is the gospel of our Lord.
Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord.
You may be seated for the hymn of the day. It's hymn 411, "Ride On, Ride On in Majesty."
Thank you.
Grace and mercy and peace be to you, from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Dear Palm Sunday worshipers, and especially you, Jack Magruder, our confirmant, the last couple Sundays, I ran an announcement in the worship folder saying that we were going to have a confirmation coming up, and I included your name in that, Jack, but we're a pretty small congregation, and most of the people in the room today are 65 years older than you are, so I'm guessing everybody knew right away who you were. But I want you to think about the fact, or if we had all kinds of other teenagers, and I made that same announcement, you may in fact know that something special is going to happen, but you might not know exactly who Jack is. And so you come here today in anticipation, knowing that something big is happening, but just waiting eagerly to get a glimpse of who Jack Magruder is. That's kind of the way it was on Palm Sunday, too. Jesus had just raised Lazarus from the dead, and they were all wondering if he was, in fact, the Messiah God promised to send them. And when they were in Jerusalem that Sunday, they knew something special was going to happen, and they were waiting and anticipating for the arrival of Jesus to catch a glimpse of maybe the one God had promised to send. When Jesus finally entered the city, they worshiped him as the Messiah. They praised him for a minute. Well, it was more than 60 seconds, but it was a brief period of time, because some of these very same people shouting his praises on Palm Sunday would in a few days be demanding his execution on a cross. Today, Jack, you're here on this Palm Sunday, and you're worshiping Jesus as King. Same is true for every single person sitting in the pew today. We're focused on him, we're praising him, we're worshiping him, but the thought I want you to take home on your confirmation day is that Jesus wants to be more than just your Messiah for a minute. He wants to be the Messiah of every moment of your life from now to eternity. But this isn't just a pep talk, because Jesus is going to give us some real solid reasons for why he's worthy of that kind of praise. He's going to answer a couple vital questions for us today. First of all, who is this Jesus? And why should we grant him lordship over our lives? Matthew tells us that when Jesus arrived in the city, the whole city was stirred up asking, who is this? And if you believe the historians, then that means that 2 million people were in Jerusalem that week to celebrate the Passover. They were all stirred up, and they were waiting for the arrival of the king God had promised them. But what kind of king? Trying to make a royal entrance into a city, instructs his disciples to do this. As they approached Jerusalem and came to Bethphage on the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two disciples, telling them, go to the village ahead of you. Immediately you will find a donkey tied there with her colt. Untie them and bring them to me. Sounds to me a little bit like Jesus jacked a couple of donkeys, don't you think? But in reality, that owner of the donkeys recognized that Jesus already owned them. Jesus already owned them because he was the one who designed them and gave them purpose. In fact, that's what he tells the disciples to say to the owner if he had questioned them about taking the donkeys. If anyone says anything to you, you are to say, the Lord needs them. And we know that the owner recognized Jesus' lordship because he lets them take the donkeys. Now, in my child brain, thinking about this account, I always pictured just one donkey. But in fact, there were two. And Matthew makes a point of that. He stresses that when he says, This took place to fulfill what was spoken through the prophet. Tell the daughter of Zion, look, your king comes to you humble and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey. Jesus did things exactly as the prophets foretold the Messiah would do them. 700 years before this very day, Isaiah wrote, tell the daughter of Zion, look, your salvation is coming. And then 200 years later, Zechariah gives us striking details about this arrival. He says, rejoice greatly, daughter of Zion. Shout, daughter of Jerusalem. Look, your king is coming to you. He's righteous and brings salvation. He's humble and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of the donkey. Why was Jesus following those prophecies exactly to the details so important? People were already giving him the cloaks off their backs, throwing them down on the ground, letting him trample on them with a donkey. They were already laying out their version of the red carpet, a carpet made of palm branches. But remember who these crowds were. Many of them had come from Galilee in the north. That was the place where Jesus did all kinds of miracles. That's where Jesus fed the 5,000 with just a few loaves of bread and a couple fish. I want you to remember and focus on their reaction to that miracle. They wanted to eat the miraculous bread. But then Jesus tells them, that's not enough to make me your bread king. That's not enough to have life. If you want to have life, then you have to eat me. I am the bread of life. You must consume me. You must make me an essential part of every moment of every day of your life. And what was their reaction? This is a hard teaching. Many of them at that point walked away and no longer followed Jesus because that was a step too far to make Jesus essential to every moment of their life. But remember, Matthew's talking about Jesus' arrival in Jerusalem, not in Galilee, 93 miles to the south. And who was in charge? It was the Pharisees. The Pharisees who hated Jesus, and they would see his arrival into Jerusalem on the back of a donkey to a king's welcome as nothing more than a coup. Doing ministry further away from Jerusalem, that was irritating enough. But riding into Jerusalem as a king, that was a step way too far. They didn't just want distance from him, they wanted him dead. I want to ask you, do you ever try to put distance between you and Jesus? And you wonder how in the world that can be, because here we are in God's house. We're worshiping him as the king. Well, we all want a little Jesus in our lives. We want to come and we're content to sit inside the walls of his house and receive his forgiveness and to thank him for his gifts in our lives. But all of us, to one degree or another, try to build walls in our lives, separating our life here at church and our lives out there at home. We'll grant him the right to be Lord of our Sunday mornings and even Lord of the surface of our spiritual lives, but that's not enough. Jesus wants to be king. Over every moment of your life, he wants to be king of the texts you send. Jesus wants to be Lord over your searches on the internet. He wants to control the content you view on your televisions. He wants authority over your relationships, how you treat the people around you, and the words that you choose to speak to them. Jesus wants to be Lord of it all, not just for a minute, but every moment of every single day, and there is part of us that rebels against that very idea. Why? Why would we do that? We don't grant that kind of authority to anyone else in our lives. From the moment our little toddler brains can comprehend the concept, we're struggling for independence from our parents, aren't we? We want our employer, our boss, to value our contribution at work, but truth be told, we'd rather not answer to the boss, we'd rather be the boss. So why would we give that kind of authority to Jesus? Lord of our universe, King of our very existence, because Jesus is the Messiah. Jesus fulfilled every single prophecy ever spoken about the Messiah. He's more than a parent. He's more than a boss. He's more than just an earthly king. He is the Lord of all. Don't just be willing to give him a minute on Sunday morning or control of your spiritual lives. Jesus wants every part of you, every thought, every word, every deed. He wants to be in control of your life and Lord of your universe every moment between now and heaven. And there's a tiny little detail that Matthew talks about that underscores why we should look at him that way. It happened after the disciples brought Jesus, the donkey, the colt, and they put their cloaks on him. Matthew simply says, matter-of-factly, Jesus sat on it. Both Mark and Luke, in their gospel accounts of the same incident, they specifically tell us that Jesus sent the disciples out looking for a colt on which no one has ever sat. You think about this, there's a reason why donkeys have a reputation for being stubborn. If they don't want to move, they're not going to move. And that's full-grown adult donkeys used to having grown adults sitting on their back, but this was a colt that no one had ever ridden before, and yet that colt accepts Jesus on his back. Why? Because the colt recognized the one sitting on his back was the one who designed it and gave it life. The colt recognized him as the Messiah with power and authority and at the same time coming in humility. Gentle and caring and yet at the same time God in human flesh. Why is it that a donkey does that so easily and you and I fight that with every bit of strength we have? And there's part of us that hates Jesus. Shocking, isn't it? Part of us that hates Jesus every bit as much as the Pharisees. There's part of us that is just as clueless about his rule and the kingdom that he rules over as the people who participated in the Palm Sunday parade. We'll give him a minute on Sunday morning, but then we spend Monday through Saturday trying to carve out a little section of our lives for us to rule. Building up walls so that we can make ourselves king over our own lives. If you were the almighty, powerful king of the universe, how would you knock down those walls? Jack, that's what he wants to do. That's what he wants to do for the people in the pew and the man standing in the pulpit as well. But if you were Jesus, how would you knock down that walls? Would you make them fall over at the very mention of your name like he did with the soldiers in the Garden of Gethsemane? Instead, while they were lying on the ground, shocked and stunned, tying them up, carrying them off to a prison where you could force them to do your will? That's what I would do. But Jesus does the opposite. He rides into Jerusalem not to stage a coup, but to surrender. Jesus comes into Jerusalem not to impose his will on the people, but to allow people to impose their will on him. To capture him, to tie him up, to deliver him to the cross, to bleed and to die. Do you understand how ironic that is? Jesus conquers by submission. Jesus defeats death by succumbing to it. He gains victory over sin by taking sin on himself that was not his own and for pouring out his blood to pay for it. He overcomes the grave by lying in it and coming out the other side alive. And he rules your life, your heart, not by force, but by through faith, allowing you to recognize that the walls that we erect to keep him away from us are nothing but prison walls, keeping us inside, keeping us separate from him and separate from his love, and preventing us from living the life that God really wants us to live. And then he gets us, by faith, for the rest of our life, to work hand in hand with the Holy Spirit, taking down those walls we put up, block by block, so that there is not a single stone that stands between us and our Savior. Jack, Jesus wants to be king of your life. People in the pew, he wants to rule you and your hearts as well, not just for a minute on Sunday morning, but every moment of every day of the rest of your life. The people in Jerusalem on Palm Sunday, they shouted words borrowed from Psalm 118. O Lord, please save us now. O Lord, grant us success. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. We bless you from the house of the Lord. You don't hear it in Matthew's text, but you can hear it in the word Hosanna. And sometimes we like to equate Hosanna with Hallelujah. Hallelujah is a statement of praise, but Hosanna is so much more. Hosanna means, Lord, come now and rescue me from myself. Lord of all, come now and be the king of my life. Oh Lord, come and save me today. We join in those words. The people who first spoke them, sure, some of them knew the full implication, but many of them had no clue what they were saying. And by God's grace, you and I know the complete meaning of those words. And so we come today not only joining their praise on Palm Sunday, but saying, Lord, make that my shout of praise today, tomorrow, and the next day too. Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Amen. The peace of God that transcends all human understanding, guard and keep your hearts and minds through faith in Christ Jesus. Amen. Please stand. We'll join in the confession of faith using Martin Luther's explanation of the second article of the Apostles' Creed. It's in the middle of page 5. I believe that Jesus Christ, true God, begotten of the Father from eternity, and also true man, born of the Virgin Mary, is my Lord. He has redeemed me, a lost and condemned creature, purchased and won me from all sins, from death and from the power of the devil, not with gold or silver, but with his holy, precious blood, and with his innocent suffering and death. All this he did that I should be his own and live under him in his kingdom and serve him in everlasting righteousness, innocence, and blessedness, just as he is risen from death and lives and rules eternally. This is most certainly true. You may be seated. We'll bring our offering to the Lord. Please take a moment as the offering is gathered or before you leave today to sign the friendship register and make sure everyone else has an opportunity to sign it as well. Having completed 2 years of instruction in the basic teachings of Scripture and having been examined before the council on Thursday afternoon, we invite Jack Magruder to come forward for the rite of confirmation. Brothers and sisters in Christ, our Lord Jesus said to his disciples, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always to the very end of the age." Jack, in obedience to the Lord's command, you have been baptized in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. You have been taught the precious truths of the Christian faith as confessed by the Evangelical Lutheran Church. You know what God has given you by his grace and what he expects of you as his dear child. You now have the privilege of receiving the Lord's body and blood in the sacrament of Holy Communion. You are here to make a public profession of your Christian faith. The Apostle Paul, writing to the Romans, said, "If you confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord, and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For it is with your heart that you believe and are justified, and it is with your mouth that you confess and are saved. Everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. Therefore, lift up your heart to the God of all grace and joyfully answer these questions. Do you this day, in the presence of God and of this congregation, acknowledge that in baptism God gave you forgiveness of sins, life, and salvation? If so, answer, I do. Do you reject the devil along with all his lies and empty promises? If so, answer, I do. Do you believe in the God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth? If so, answer, I do. Do you believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried, descended into hell, rose again from the dead on the third day, ascended into heaven, and now sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty, and from there will come to judge the living and the dead? If so, answer, I do. Do you believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting? If so, answer, I do. Do you believe that all the accepted books of the Bible are truly the inspired word of God, and that the teachings of the Bible, as they're confessed by our Evangelical Lutheran Church, which you've learned to know from Martin Luther's Small Catechism, are true and correct? If so, then answer, I do. Do you intend also to continue faithfully in the teachings of the Word of God and of the Evangelical Lutheran Church and suffer anything, even death, rather than fall away from them? If so, answer, I do so intend with the help of God. Finally, do you intend with God's help to faithfully live your whole life according to the Word of God, to be diligent in the use of the Word and sacraments, and in faith and action remain true to God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, as long as you live? If so, then answer, I do. Since it is God alone who enables us both to will and to do his good pleasure, it's right for us, dear friends in Christ, to call on him for Jack, that he would graciously complete the good work which he has begun in him. Let us therefore bow our heads and pray. Gracious Father, you have adopted Jack in baptism and anointed him with your Holy Spirit. Renew and strengthen him by that same Spirit, so that he may continue to grow in faith and boldly confess you before others. Move him to faithfully hear your word and joyfully receive your sacrament, that he may again and again be assured of your gracious love and forgiveness. Give him the sincere desire to die each day to sin, and to put on the new self, created to be like God in true righteousness and holiness. Clothe him with the kindness, humility, and patience of Christ, and so that he may live at peace with all the members of Christ's body. Protect him from all the powers of evil, and give him the weapons to fight against the devil. Keep him faithful and holy, so that he may inherit eternal life through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Jack Arthur Magruder. May God the Father who created you, may God the Son who redeemed you, may God the Holy Spirit who sanctified you keep you faithful until life everlasting. Upon this, your profession and promise, I invite and welcome you as a member of the Evangelical Lutheran Church and of this congregation to receive the Lord's Supper at the Lord's altar as a symbol of your promise and receive his blessing, and to share with us in all the gifts of the Lord has for his church, living them out continually in his worship and service. You may depart in peace. Our prayers have been requested on behalf of the family and friends of Phyllis Nelson, our winter resident who was called home to heaven this past week. Her funeral was conducted yesterday. We pray. Heavenly Father, comfort the family of Phyllis Nelson, whom you've now called to eternal glory in heaven. We praise you for making her your dear child in baptism and sustaining her faith through the good news about Jesus, our Savior. We thank you for the blessings you brought to your church, this community, and her family through her Christian life of service. May the peace and promise of your Son's atoning sacrifice on the cross and his empty tomb bring assurance to the hearts of all who mourn. Help us always to live in joyful anticipation of the day when you will call us from our graves, reunite us with Phyllis and all believers, and fill us with the perfect bliss in your presence forever. Amen. We'll continue with liturgy on the top of page 6 of your worship folder. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
We lift our hearts in praise and song.
To you, Lord God, to you.
To thank you, bless you, and honor you, O holy, gracious Lord.
To praise and glorify you is our right and good.
It is truly good and right that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, Holy Lord, Almighty Father, everlasting God, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who brought the gift of salvation to all people by his death on the tree of the cross, so that the devil who overcame us by a tree would in turn by a tree be overcome. Therefore, with all the saints on earth and hosts of heaven, we praise your holy name and join their glorious song.
Blessed are you, Lord God, eternal King and gracious Father. In love you made us the crown of your creation. In mercy you planned our salvation. In grace you sent your Son to redeem us from sin. We remember and give you thanks that your eternal Son, Jesus Christ, became flesh and made his dwelling among us, that he willingly placed himself under law to redeem those under law, that he humbled himself by becoming obedient to death on a cross, that he has destroyed death and brought life and immortality to light through the gospel. Bless us as we receive your Son's body and blood in the sacrament. Forgive our sins, increase our faith, strengthen our fellowship, and deepen our longing for the day when Christ will welcome us to his eternal feast. Praise and thanks and honor and glory be to you, O God, our Father, and to your Son and to the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
The Lord Jesus Christ, on the night he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Then he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this whenever you drink it, in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always. We'd like to invite our confirmand and his family to come up for this, the first table for communion.
your own death, for the forgiveness of your sins. Take and drink. This is the true blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, shed for you for the forgiveness of all your sins. May this strengthen and preserve you in the luxury of faith until life everlasting. Depart in peace.
Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good.
And his mercy endures forever.
Whenever we eat this bread and drink this cup,
we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.
O God the Father, source of all goodness, in your loving kindness you sent your Son to share our humanity. We thank you that through him you have given us pardon and peace in this sacrament. We also pray that you will not forsake us, but will rule our hearts and minds by your Holy Spirit, so that we willingly serve you day after day through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look on you with favor and give you peace.
Amen.
You may be seated.
I want to welcome you, all of you, especially visitors today, friends and family of Jack. We're glad to have you with us today. We've been practicing a couple songs for our Easter celebration. We're going to do that again. I'm going to say we're going to practice three of them.